Hello everyone, I'm curator Emily Hannam and welcome to Eastern Encounters, four centuries of paintings and manuscripts from the Indian subcontinent, which is the Royal Collection's exciting new exhibition here at the Queen's Gallery at the Palace of Holyrood House in Edinburgh. As many of you know, the Indian subcontinent is home to some of the richest cultural and artistic traditions in the world. And over hundreds of years, members of the British royal family have acquired a magnificent and really wide-ranging collection of South Asian art. But how do you tell a story of such richness and diversity in one exhibition? Well, the answer I came up with is through the encounters, from early encounters with the Mughal emperors to divine encounters with Hindu gods to encounters with the Raj. In this exhibition, we travel through time to explore the encounters and often very personal relationships between the British royal family and the rulers of South Asia. But as well as telling these previously untold stories of Indian history, this exhibition tells a new and dynamic story of Indian art, of artistic connections going back and forth, and cultural resonances that echo throughout the centuries. And it's very important that we're showing this exhibition here in the UK, because this is not a one-sided story. This is a shared history of South Asia and Britain, and one that is inextricably linked to the Britain of today. The first part of the exhibition is called Early Encounters, and here you will explore the art of the great moguls. These exquisite and jewel-like paintings and manuscripts all date to an era when the Mughal Empire of India was richer and stronger than any European power. The British royal ambassadors like Sir Thomas Rowe, depicted here in green, were overawed by the riches that they encountered there. It was a place where Indian, Iranian, Central Asian, Chinese, and European cultures all converged. And we can really see that in the type of artwork that the Mughals created, like this extraordinary reinterpretation of a 16th century Flemish print depicting the Day of Judgment. Also on display, we have some magnificent works of art commissioned by the fifth Mughal emperor, Shah Jahan. Shah Jahan's artist painted miniatures on an enormous scale. Grand scenes like this, which show the Mughal emperor taking part in ceremonies and appearing to his subjects from the balconies of the royal palaces. Shah Jahan was a contemporary of King Charles I, and the two actually exchanged several letters. One of these was a grovelling letter of apology that Charles I was compelled to send to Shah Jahan after the Mughal emperor's ships were plundered by pirates who were said to have been flying the English flag. In Political Encounters, we explore art and the East India Company in these works of art dating from the 18th and early 19th centuries. On display are gifts of paintings and manuscripts that were sent by Indian rulers to British monarchs as appeals for their favour and their protection. We're also showing gifts that the East India Company officers presented to both George III and George IV as symbols of their successes in India and of their control. The presence of the East India Company had a huge impact on the politics of the Indian subcontinent, but it left its impression on India's art as well, as Indian artists adopted not just European imagery, but also European materials and techniques in their work. This oil painting depicts Akbar Shah II, the penultimate Mughal emperor, who's seated with his sons. It's by a Mughal artist who evidently adopted European stylistic conventions for his work. And he did this very deliberately, thinking about the painting's intended viewer, because the emperor sent this work as a gift to George IV with a letter very anxiously appealing for his help in improving his relationship with the East India Company. In Victorian Encounters, we explore gifts of books, paintings, and manuscripts all sent to Queen Victoria. This part of the exhibition covers the early years of British Crown rule in India after 1858, when the Mughal Emperor was deposed, the East India Company collapsed, and control of all of its territories in South Asia now transferred directly to the British Crown. Queen Victoria later assumes the title Empress of India. And among the books sent to Queen Victoria by Indian rulers were several translations of her own best-selling book about her holidays in Scotland.
This is the opening page of a Hindi translation of her book made by Ishwari Prasad Narayan Singh, the Maharaja of Benares. It's a hand-coloured composite image that consists of both photographic and painted elements, and it depicts an imaginary encounter in which the Maharaja presents his book to the Queen. The painting was probably made by Madho Prasad, a member of an old artist family from Patna. And he had worked with the Maharaja's family in Benares for generations and took up photography in the 1860s. 20 years later, the next Maharaja of Benares, Prabhu Narayan Singh, actually used the same composition and the same print of Queen Victoria for this image, which commemorates his sending of an album of photographs to the Queen for her Golden Jubilee. In Divine Encounters, we explore the Royal Collection's incredible holdings of Hindu paintings from northern India, many of which were brought back by Queen Victoria's son, Albert Edward, the future King Edward VII, from his tour of India in 1875. When he was in Bombay, the prince attended the wedding celebrations of the son of a local wealthy businessman, who presented Albert Edward with three large albums containing these beautiful Rajput paintings of Hindu deities. It was around the time of the prince's tour that scholars in Europe started to think about India as the cradle of world civilization. They realized that the name Abraham, the Jewish, Christian, and Islamic patriarch, has its roots in Brahma, the Hindu god of creation. And Abraham's wife, Sarah, comes from Sarasvati, Brahma's consort, the Hindu goddess of learning and the arts. And so in these paintings, the British prince could learn about Hindu religious and spiritual life, and about these wider cultural connections too. The final part of the exhibition is called Encountering the Raj and explores ideas of tradition and modernity in early 20th century India. Here we're excited to be able to display some previously unseen images from the photograph collection that were taken during the period of British Crown rule known as the British Raj, when members of the British royal family made grand public tours of the Indian subcontinent. Throughout these tours, they adopted South Asian courtly rituals of durbars, of processions, and big game hunts, and they really projected themselves as heirs to the Mughal emperors of the past. George V and Queen Mary were the first reigning British monarchs to ever set foot on Indian soil, and this extraordinary panorama is a record of the huge imperial ceremony that was the 1911 Delhi Coronation Durbar, where they officially proclaimed themselves Emperor and Empress of India. This photograph was taken the following day at the Mughal Red Fort when George V and Queen Mary very consciously put on their robes and crowns and showed themselves to thousands of people stood on the balcony exactly where the Mughal emperors formally showed themselves. Its composition is not dissimilar to the paintings of the Mughal court scenes seen earlier in the exhibition, with the emperor shown on the balcony at the centre. But the atmosphere and the sensation could not be more different. The crowds are all out of shot, and in the place of rows of distinguished courtiers are just a few potted plants and some awkwardly placed chairs. But just as the British royal family looked to the past and revived earlier South Asian traditions, so too did many South Asian painters of the early 20th century. The final work in the exhibition is this painting by Abanindranath Tagore, the founder of the Bengal school and widely considered the father of Indian modernism. The painting was given as a gift to Queen Mary in Calcutta just a few days after the Delhi Durbar. It depicts the ancient Buddhist Indian queen Tisarakshita, wife of Emperor Ashoka, and it has quite a Mughal character. It's painted in watercolour, it's miniature-sized, and she's depicted in profile, but it also has that emotional intensity that you find in traditional Rajput painting. So it's a painting that both looks back to earlier Indian history and art, as well as looking forward, because at this very important moment in Indian history, Tagore created new and modern art for a new and modern India. I've shown you just some of the more than 100 beautiful works of art from the Indian subcontinent in this exhibition, many of them on display here in Scotland for the very first time. We really look forward to welcoming you to the Queen's Gallery and hope that you enjoy exploring this fascinating and important part of the Royal Collection.